pleasure and honor to be invited to speak about these issues that lies very close to my heart. And in what comes here now, it's a perhaps a little bit different take than the transformation of the future of money, because with it goes the issue of tax and taxation. And this is what I will speak about. So, why do people pay tax, and why do they avoid doing so, and how are we made to pay tax? There are many disciplines that try to answer these questions: economics, law, accounting, psychology, and so on. And they use a wide variety of methods and come up with similarly a diverse array of solutions and theories. I'm a social anthropologist researching taxation. So given the time today, I can only give you a small hint about some research going on. And as a Swede, it is a smorgasbord that I will offer with just small appetizers. I want to inspire you drawing on an anthropological research on tax, but also point out a number of issues to consider when transforming the future of money, as if tax is going to be part of such a transformation. There, first of all, there is a difference between tax and taxation. Tax is typically the percentage or on services or commodities or a share or a fixed amount of something, whereas taxation is the practice of collecting these monies. And it is the combination of those which makes taxpayers comply, if we want to pay our taxes or not, and if we are made to pay it. And taxes should not only serve to finance the government. American economist Richard Musgrave distinguishes taxation between three different objectives: resource allocation, income redistribution, and economic stability. And now, noteworthy, we are still only on the collection side of tax, not on the spending side. Yet, already it is much more than to collect income to a state or a governmental body. For example, to attract businesses, change consumption patterns, redirect investments, create incentives for citizens to make sustainable choices, distribute income more equally. As philosopher Hans Gribnau, and also tax philosopher or tax professor Hans Gribnau writes, tax legislation for non-fiscal goals is an integral part of government policy. Taxes and the ways taxes are collected begs the question of the impact on society and also on taxpayers writ large, or perhaps as a social network or human relationships or a social organization, borrowing from the issues that our panel yesterday were set to discuss. Now, my take on taxation is that it creates relations. All citizens supposedly pay taxes and all supposedly benefit from them. Regardless in which country we live and regardless of how taxes are collected, we usually get something for it: infrastructure, education, health services, security, defense, police, you name it. Tax payments are exchanges without direct repayment, like for example compared to a market transaction. Yet there are inherent reciprocal elements. Paying tax, being made to pay tax, creates expectations of getting something. And if not getting something, it creates animosity. Tax collection in practice, thus, has an impact on how taxpayers view their relationship with the government and ultimately with other citizens. Because this view changes our focus from legal explanations and economic quantifications to descriptions of the type of reciprocal relations taxes and tax collection entail. For example, drawing on Marcel Mauss and his seminal book, The Gift. Who has read it here?
Which book?
The Gift. Yeah. It's said to be the most wrongly named book in social science by Keith Hart, as it discusses so much more than the altruistic transfer of a good. And Mauss stated, and this was 100 years ago, that the predicament of giving something is threefold: to give, to receive, and to give again. And any start of an exchange, whether it is a helping hand, a barter, swap, transfer, and even a market transaction, or perhaps even theft, it's not there? It's coming. I didn't write too much about it, was there, so I'm just telling you about it. And even theft demands a counteraction, and thereby creates a relationship between the exchangers. giving, receiving, and giving again can be said to be made to make society possible. It is the very idea on which the European Union was made. People who trade do not fight if the trade is beneficial for them. And taxation can be seen through this lens. People who pay tax and benefit from their redistribution have one less thing to fight over. Tax is an explicit economic relationship between a citizen and his or her state, or the type of community we live in, but also the implicit economic relationship with all other citizens or part of that community. Research claims that we are more willing to pay taxes if everybody else pay their fair share, or at least we perceive that this is the case. Seeing exchanges as creating relations, living in a welfare state, or any state where paying lots of taxes but also perceiving to get something for them creates a strong relation with it. I wrote here a holistic perspective. Avoid the easy explanations. There are bad morals, but it's not only the morals why we pay tax. There are the simple economic reasonings. It is cheaper, obviously, to avoid paying tax if you are given the choice. There are also political, ideological, static categories of different kinds. And you know the reason, you know the arguments. The rich do not pay taxes. The poor, they are the ones who pay, etc., etc., etc. And it's usually a combination of these, and this is the tax compliance research shows right there, quite well. Anthropologists apply a qualitative perspective on tax compliance and taxation. So I study taxation as a practice, seeing what people do and what tools and knowledge they apply. We study what people say and do, the techniques and knowledges, the assumptions for models and experiments, the application of law, the anecdotes and hunches used, even the history and people's irrational behavior. Because I also aim to understand, while people do not always, sometimes, or often do, what they say they do. This does not mean that people are liars. We are just not the rational beings that sometimes science claims us to be. A useful theoretical approach in this, to me, has been the actor network theory, as proposed by Michel Calon and Bruno Latour, among others, which is perhaps not so much of a theory as a research strategy. But this theory aims to identify all actors that, in different constellations, make up knowledge that shapes our world, yet without taking the constellations for granted. So the law, the models, the theories, the history, and so on. Here I just brought in some work done on tax, so you can just see it and we can send it along, but I won't. I would like to go quickly forward to give Frank some time also to say some things.
That's okay.
Yeah. But I would also make some notes about the comparative perspective. Because we can compare. In a recent Horizon 2020 funded project, we made a comparison beyond differences in jurisdictions, economic outcomes, and organizations. And it was on cooperative compliance, which is a model that the OECD proposes, aiming to establish closer collaborations between tax administrations and multinational enterprises in the name of efficiency and increased tax compliance. So we engage with all stakeholders on national tax arenas, in this case in a number of northern European countries, where we compare the practice of cooperative compliance models. So we proposed, as an explanation, the cultural, institutional, and societal factors that influenced the compliance practices and found. So we found that, and first, that tax compliance does not only depend on the will of the taxpayers, in this case these multinational enterprises, but it's as much shaped in the course of actual interaction between them and the tax administrations. Second, key principles of these OECD guidelines, namely voluntary disclosure and real-time responses, are too narrow and perhaps even too idealistic to be feasible. We show that real-time responses are generally highly valued, but are neither welcome nor possible under all circumstances. It is actually much more crucial to be explicit about a change in time frame than to have all the interaction real-time. And third, the possibility to get reliable measurements and evaluations of effect when it comes to property compliance is highly sought after, yet much of it a dream. And this goes across the taxation field. And noteworthy, and this research is the Swedish exception. I spent 3 years doing fieldwork at Swedish Tax Administration, trying to understand why they are one of the most revered governmental bureaucracies in Sweden. And I wrote a book and a number of articles on this. But in this case, on the property compliance model, the result was it's a failure. It doesn't work in Swedish society. Foremost because of the law, but also because of other issues. So why I'm being very explicit on just this research is just to show you the type of insights that we can gather out by applying a holistic perspective. Most of all, I think one has to thinking about taxation along with the transformation of the future of money, as the title of this workshop is retain the curiosity. Not to be normative in the sense that more taxes are always better. Do not condemn just perceived tax avoiders or evaders. There are certainly many that avoid and evade tax. Yet we have to start and give them the benefit of the why. Why do taxpayers pay tax? And why do they avoid doing so? And how are they made to do this? Many are very moral in their explanations, but researchers should not provide a moralizing account, but perhaps try to examine the moral reasonings among various stakeholders. Because there are corrupt tax administrations, there are a number of fiddling with money, I mean, trying to go to the depth with this. There are numerous challenges. We have talked a lot about the climate challenges. We have the digitization. We have increasing inequalities in society. And therefore, I would like to argue this, that we also have to think, when we do this changes with money, we also have to think really through of how we're going to tax such money. If it's going to be this 5 trillion that Stefan Brudenhofer speaks about, released annually, how is that money going to be taxed? How is it going to be filtered throughout society? The holistic perspective, I mentioned that. I also would like to say, well, with the holistic perspective, think about more than the human behavior. Also, what tools they have to work with, the organizations, the law they have to interpret, etc. Take people seriously. There are good reasons for irrational, stupid behavior. I mean, we talked about, there was someone proposed a behavioral economics, right? But there is also a whole wealth of work and people paying and avoid paying tax out there, which we can study. It is difficult, if not impossible, to know people's intentions, the why. People do not always say what they do. Think about it carefully, the pre-established issues. Categories cannot be taken for granted. Like the former strategist of the Swedish Tax Agency who told me that I made the metaphor of driving too fast with a car, and he said that we know that young men with fast cars usually have a tendency to drive faster than other people. However, we are not aiming just for them, we're aiming for all who drive fast. And the same perspective should be thought about when we try to get these who evade and avoid taxes. Organizations, if we study them, have one voice, yet there are people with many, with various tax agendas and agency. So, giving voice to the overlooked people. So rethinking money means rethinking tax and taxation.